So the Zereshim Shana Parshas Vayechi, if you would turn to page Tav Nun Zayin, that's Tav Nun Zayin in the middle of the Parsha. The Zereshim Shana asks such a great question. It's such a great question that I've never seen anyone ask this question before. He's referring to the blessings of Yaakov, which actually begin with not such great blessings, but more like almost curses. I mean, he uses the word curse with his sons, Shimon and Levi. And he says, Shimon v'Levi achim. Shimon and Levi, you are brothers, troublemakers, destroyers, a whole bunch of other things, and therefore you will be dispersed amongst the Jewish people. So Zerah Shimshon wants to know, Achim, brothers, that's a big compliment. That's a really nice thing. Why does Yaakov open his rebuke and his chastising of Shimon and Levi with what really is a great compliment towards them, that they are the example of brothers? At least that's the simple reading of it. So if you look on page Tav Nun Zayin in the right column, the second paragraph, V'adayin yesh ledaktik. So we still remain with one question. Lama karim achim v'inyan zeh. Why are they called brothers? Furthermore, im adarabah, on the contrary, b'shah sha'amru, when they said l'chu v'nahargeyu, let us go and kill him, our sages tell us, Rashi tells us, hisiu atzma min ha'achva, they completely removed themselves from brotherhood. Brothers don't do that to each other. So in order for them to sell, or they were going to kill, in order for them to kill Yosef, they completely erased, nullified, ignored, removed from their minds their being brothers of Yosef. Kedepirush Rashi al-Pasik, Rashi explains this on the verse, Nasu Mizeh, they've traveled from this, and really it should say they traveled from here, but it means they traveled from this, from the brotherhood. So these are people, these are two people, Shimon and Levi, who erased their brother from their mind. They erased a family member. And we call them Achim. We say Shimon and Levi Achim as if they are the great example of brothers. So you might say, well, yeah, they've erased themselves of the brotherhood of Yosef, but not from the other brothers. He says, "Avshalom nasu elam and achvash al Yosef." Now, even though they've only erased 1/11th, or together with all the brothers, 1/12th of their brotherhood, v'lo mi'achvash alahem, and the two of them, Shimon and Levi, remain strong in their brotherhood. Im kozel lo shayech lomer achim be'inyan zeh, but we wouldn't call them; they are the brothers, as if they are the example of brotherhood. The hashta kavanas Yaakov, because we understand the intention of Yaakov, hayaladaber b'gnusam, is to speak negative of them. V'lashan achim, referring to these two as brothers, who lashan shavach v'lo gnus, is a praise, and not something degrading. So the Zera Shimsha tells us an explanation. No one says this. V'yesh lomar, the Issa b'medrash al pasuk, there's a famous medrash on the pasuk. V'yishma Ruvain v'yatzileu. Ruvain heard what the brothers were discussing, and he decided he was going to save Yosef, and in fact he does save Yosef. He has stopped Shimon and Levi from killing him directly. So, says the medrash, Amar Ruvain, Ruvain said, Ani b'chor, I am the firstborn. V'ein hasirchon talui elabi, and transgression, but really blame,
odiousness,
there you go, will be on me. Upirishama yifei toar, so the commentaries explain there, ein zemitzad tarumas aviv, he's not talking about his father blaming him, because if Yaakov finds out that Yosef was murdered, which is what they were going to do at that time, it's unlikely that he would only blame the firstborn. Va'od, ilu yargu, furthermore, if they were going to kill Yosef, yachrimu beinehem, they would obviously make a pact, shlo yigalu, that no one would reveal, k'mo she'asu b'mechira, as that's what happened with the sale of Yosef. The brothers actually made a pact, they made a cherem, and cherem is so powerful that even God himself was locked out of being able to tell Yaakov, because God follows the Torah, and when you make a cherem like that, even God wouldn't tell. That's why Yitzchak, who knew through prophecy, wouldn't tell Yaakov that Yosef was still alive. This was a serious thing. So that the same thing would have been done had they killed Yosef, in which case Yaakov would never find out. So when Reuven says the blame would be on me, it can't be that Reuven was afraid that Yaakov would blame him. El mitzad achiv atzmam, he would be blamed by the brothers. Ki achar amaisa, because even when, at the time of the passion of the judgment of the experience, the brothers were so angry and overwhelmed and they had the opportunity, and we get lost in the frenzy of the crowd. One of the most dangerous things in the world is a crowd, because you can reason with an individual. But once it reaches a certain size, and that's not really a very big number, at that point the crowd creates a frenzy, and they lose their individual judgment. Right? That's why you have to send out the police, and sometimes they have to use force, because people don't understand, well, why don't you negotiate? Well, you try negotiating, you can't stop a crowd. So, but once it's over, at that point, the crowd looks around at themselves and says, what have we done? What did we do? Each person gets back their individual free will and they look at themselves and say, was I really part of that mad, crazy crowd with pitchforks and lanterns? So he says, the next day, after the action, after the deed, they'll recant, they'll feel bad, they'll regret. And what's the next thing you do after the crowd does something crazy and it's out of control and completely loses all rational thought, and they do something crazy, they kill someone, they beat, afterwards, when they're finished, what do?
Blame someone.
Find someone to blame. So they'll turn to the first person they could blame, that's the firstborn. You should have stopped us. Mivo bedamim, of spilling blood. You're the firstborn. And this isn't just a guess, because that's actually what happened. Commotion is Ramuel Yehuda, we see that after they sold Yosef, they blamed Yehuda the next day. Shalomicha b'mechir, why didn't you stop us from selling? Kamosha Perish Rashi. Gabi vayered Yehuda me'es achav. It says Yosef went down to Mitzrayim. And the next verse says that Yehuda went down from his brothers. And Rashi tells us that Yehuda was the royalty based on this prophecy that they had. They understood Yehuda would be the king in the future. And therefore they gave him this position and title of the royalty of the king. And after he had made the suggestion that Yosef should be sold, even though he did save Yosef's life, the next day they regretted what they'd done when they saw the pain that it caused their father. And they turned to you, they said, you should have stopped us, we're blaming you, even though the same brothers who wanted to kill Yosef, we're now blaming Yehuda for not saving Yosef enough, because that's how people work. So Reuven is saying that Vayishma Reuven Vayatzilehu, the reason why Reuven saves him is because Reuven knows this. He knows that this is what's going to happen. Tomorrow they are going to regret, and then they're going to blame me. And he stopped himself in the crowd's frenzy. All the people are driven, there's this power of the crowd that once they're lost in it, there really is nothing that they won't do. And for someone to stop and stop the crowd and say, no, listen, this is not what we're going to do, that was Reuven's act of heroism, to realize, to say, right now it feels like what we're doing is what we're meant to be doing, but tomorrow we're all going to regret, and it's going to come back on me, and he stops. That's how he understands Reuven stopping.
If Levi is
is so impetuous and so wants to fight, why does he get this huge reward when rewards are...
Levi getting his kahuna is based on his ability to, over the years, to correct that. Yeah, clearly, and that's why we say, someone who's that kind of impulsive person, for them to become someone who uses that for the positive and doesn't do that, that's even greater than someone who's just born naturally come. Yeah, Levi is the one, they're called as Rizim, the Kohanim. The Gemara says that many halachas that apply outside of the Beis HaMikdash don't apply in the Beis HaMikdash, because Kohanim are naturally bezrizos, they're quick to move, they're passionate and excited and fervous and fervent and all these other things, and that can be used for the positive. Okay,
now,
so...
Gorsh, what kind of a blessing is there Yaakov is giving his children? Is it all negative? And if I didn't know anything else, I would say he's sort of like rebuking them.
Well, the first three children, yeah, absolutely. Reuven, Shimon, and Levi get it hard. But you know, it's better to get it in this world than to get it in the next. Okay, so now coming back to Shimon and Levi. Says the Zerah Shimshon, where he pulled this out from, I don't know, but he says, Lefiza Yesh Lomar. So I want to suggest, says Zerah Shimshon, Shema Shekaram Achim, when Yaakov says Shimon and Levi are brothers, Hu Legreusa, he is saying this as a negative thing. Lomar, he means, Shalonischartu me'olam al hadavar. I know, says Yaakov, that the two of you, Shimon and Levi, still don't regret what you did to Yosef. Sha'arei tamid hayu achim devukim zeh bezeh, because their relationship never changed. Shimon and Levi were the two brothers who stuck together. They were best friends. They got along all the time. They wiped out the city of Shechem, just the two of them. According to our tradition, one was 12, the other one was 13. And it doesn't take much midrash. It's actually almost literally in the verse, because if you count the years that that they were there. So they were 12 and 13, Shimon and Levi, when they wiped out the city of Shechem. And they were together. And says Yaakov, I know what happened. Yaakov, this is certainly according to the way Rashi, Yaakov really figures out what happened. And he sees no change in Shimon and Levi's relationship. They're still the same brothers. She'ima yimischartim, had there been any regret, hayelo lasheni lisraim alarishin, there should have been some difficulty in their relationship. One of them should have complained against the other. Shehizchilis nakav al yosel amisa, whoever started it. Whoever started it and convinced the other, whoever came up with the idea, Kedachsiv says, Vayomru ish alachiv, and one said to his brother, Hine bala chalomos, here comes the dreamer. So whoever that one was, the other one should have harbored some kind of complaint against the other. Amnam shara shvatim nischartu, while all the other brothers regretted, Yehuda, and because they were the majority, they fired Yehuda from being the position. Af kishiyardu ache Yosef bedas shalom livdoso, and even when the brothers went down to Egypt, and we know why did they go down to Egypt? They were going to find Yosef and they were going to redeem him. Kamoshipirish Rashi Shemaz Rashi explains. Mikal makom ksiv asara, it says they came down 10, not 1. The vishalohoisa ava v'sina shal kulam shava, because they weren't all the same in their level of love and hatred. Velo iskimu livdoso. And so Shimon and Levi only agreed to redeem Yosef, either because they were giving in to the rest of the brothers, or they felt bad for their father. But Shimon and Levi, even at this point, would have, if they could go back again, they would have sold Yosef all over again. And Yaakov says to them, Shimon v'Levi achim, you're still brothers. You're still connected in the same way. You're still of the same opinion. And therefore, that's why he was giving out these curses. What an incredible pshat from the Zerah Shimshon.
The use of the word Echav and then Achim is part of what Yaakov is saying, first of all,
where do you have the Echav and the Achim?
One said to his...
Well, that's the, early in Parshas about Yeshev.
Right, but he, in other words,
well,
he
Achiv.
Was... Achiv. I'm sorry, Achiv. That Yaakov is saying, I know you're the ones, the two who instigated it, because you're the Achim.
Oh, one, that's very good. Right. He doesn't say that, but that's a good point. If there's... If Vayomru Ish El Achiv, the Torah's shy about identifying who they are, we know it's Shimon and Levi, but the Torah just calls them Vayomru Ish El Achiv, as if the Torah doesn't want to tell us who it was, in which case the use of Shimon and Levi Achim,
yeah,
that's very good, would actually be pointing them, you are those,
you are the, instigator.
The anonymous brothers.
Yeah, yeah.
Very good. Okay.
What does it say at Sarah, based on what you just said, I would have thought Tesha. Because
the Torah says that all of them had different levels of hate and love. That's why they were not all in the same place, the brothers.
But we're saying, you're saying Shimon and Levi were in the same place.
That's a good point. Okay, it could be that it would. I don't know if you could say Asar and Tesha. You would have to say either one or ten. Because you can't say nine brothers came down. That would be difficult in the verse, right? You still have to have a simple reading.
Yeah.
Okay.
I know this isn't related to this, but if Shimon and Levi were 12 and 13, then Dina was 5 or 6, and she was captured by Shlomo.
Dina would be 6 or 7, yeah. Yeah. I mean, Rivka's 3 when she's drawing water. Obviously, they had a different...
Yeah, it says that it's weighted...
No, I'm saying the drawing of the water. So clearly they were more mature than we would imagine. But yeah, yeah, absolutely. The point you're making is a good one, and I think it's taken by everyone as done to be understood. But yeah, that's it doesn't even require midrash. Just a simple reading of the pasuk has that after Yosef is born. They start, Yaakov stays for another 6 years, that's clearly written in the Torah, and on the trip back, which at most took 2 years, at most, because you've got a, based on their calculations of being gone for 22 years, so he was gone, he was in Laban's house for 20 years, that the Torah tells us, and we know there's 2 more years that he's on the road until he makes it back, so somewhere during that process, so she would be about 6 or 7, somewhere in there. Okay, we're now turning earlier to page Taf Nun Beis. Okay, I just want to read the pasuk inside so you understand what's bothering him. He doesn't quote the whole pasuk here. But this is referring earlier when Yaakov calls for Yosef, and Yosef comes with his sons, Menashe and Ephraim. It says, Vayomer Yisrael al Yosef. Yaakov says to Yosef, Re'o fanecha lo filalti. I never dreamed that I would even get to see your face again. Vehine hera osi elokim, and now God has shown me not just you, but your children. So he says, the Zer Shimshon, Makshim Olam, the world asks, Ma Yikesha Yesh L'Tchilas HaMikra Im Sofo. What's the flow of the verse? He should have said, I did not expect to see your face, and now I've seen your face, or the face of your children, but to see your children, V'od. All this would make sense if this is the first time that he's seeing his Einik, Menashe and Ephraim. Yaakov is saying this close to his death. 17 years. He saw them. Umalamdam Torah, and he learned Torah with them. Now that Yosef shows up for the last time, now he says, I can't believe this. I thought he's been hanging out with his grandchildren for 17 years.
It's a review.
Right, but he's saying it here, and he doesn't say it there about the grandchildren. Right. Va'od kasha, furthermore, ma ba'lamdenu b'pasik zeh. What is this verse coming to teach us? What's the point of the Torah telling us this? What are we supposed to learn from it? Va'od kasha, and a further difficulty, shu epecha pasik ha'kodmi. Look in the previous verse. Ve'enei Yisrael kavdu, Yaakov's eyes were weak. La yuchal liros, he couldn't see. Ve'eich ka'amar, rei panecha. Why would he use the word see? I never expected to see her face. Now he's unable to see. According to the commentaries, it says Vayishak lehem, Vayichabek lehem. He could barely find them, his grandchildren, because he was having trouble seeing. So why does he use the term seeing as if he was now able to see? V'yesh lomar, so he wants to suggest, Shariyazu, that the seeing in this verse, Eina Ria Tivis, is not referring to the physical, natural seeing. And L'Ria Sichlis, it's an intellectual seeing. B'chachmas ha-partzuf shahayelo. There's the wisdom of the construct of the face. I'm going to explain this a little bit, because it's a fascinating concept. We talked about it a little bit. The human beings really look alike. Human beings look like humans. Much as we have trouble telling tigers and zebras apart from each other, tigers and zebras have trouble telling us apart. Now, it doesn't make sense to us because we all look so different, but so do the tigers to each other. That's just the way that it works. To them, so what do you look like? So most of us think that we look like whatever we were born to look like, except you'll find that people who are spent a lot of time together start to look like each other. Spouses start to look like each other. Now, children, siblings look like each other because they share DNA. There's no reason why spouses should start to look like each other. And you may have noticed this, and it's actually true, people start to look like their pets. Why is that? The reason is because besides for the way that you naturally look, the way that you contort your face is actually part of what you look like. And little nuances and movements of the face and the way that you hold your face, which has an infinite number of combinations, over time you start to develop and shift towards looking like whatever person you spend a lot of time with, or whatever animal or creature you may spend a lot of time with. It's not the other way. People think, they make the mistake of thinking that people buy pets that look like them. But it doesn't work that. It's actually the other way. There's small, slight changes which we don't realize. And over many years, that shifts. Which means that the way that your face is a combination of the natural look of your face and what you've adopted and learned. There's a nature and a nurture in what your face looks like. And so much like your soul and your personalities and your attributes, you have a certain natural inclination towards certain things, as the Rambam writes famously, that there are three different kinds of midos. There's the midos which you were naturally born with. You were going to have that even if you weren't going to learn it. There are the midos, the attributes which you were inclined to. And then there's the midos, which are not part of your natural approach, but you picked it up from other people or from society and things like that. In the same way, so the chachmas ha-partzuf, the wisdom of the face, is the knowledge to study the face and know the personality of the person based on the shifts within the face. And there are ancient Kabbalistic books that are written on the description of these things. There are people who are experts in this area, and they can look at a person's face, and some of it being natural and some of it being learned, and they can make assessments about that person, much like you can study handwriting in the science of graphology, which, yeah, I've seen it in action. It works. It really works. It's a science, and it's studied and known, and even though it's not so much in use today, because handwriting barely exists anymore, but when you write, you put yourself in your writing, and you can learn so much, not just from the words that the person uses, that's really not part of it, but in the shapes that the letters take, and the distances in the shapes, and the slants of the writing, and the distances of the margins, and all these things, they can tell a million things about you, to the point where sometimes when they negotiate with terrorists, in places where they do negotiate with terrorists, they will use graphologists to study the writing of the terrorists, and that's why they'll specifically have them fill out a written piece of paper with this information to tell whether or not the person is actually going to follow through with their promise. And as much as they won't tell you the truth, they'll put into the writing whether or not they're going to follow through. And there's a similar kind of wisdom of the study of the face. So says the Zeres Shimshon that Yaakov was an expert in the Chachmas HaPartzuf. Vayar Yisrael as b'nei Yosef, and Yisrael saw the sons of Yosef. V'zeh atam shehigdim ha'kosev, he's saying, V'enei Yisrael, the eyes of Yaakov, lo yuchal liros, he couldn't see properly. His vision was cloudy. Because the Torah wants to tell you what I'm about to tell you in the next verse, which is that Yaakov saw something in Yosef. It's not that he saw them for the first time. That at this point, Yaakov studied, and I guess he still had enough vision to be able to do that, he studied Yosef's construct of his face. Behind him. So he says, as we know, Yaakov was about to bless his grandchildren, and the Shechina left him. Rashi tells us that he said, who are these children? Why is he asking who are these children? It's because he felt there was something wrong. The Shechina left him. So he started thinking, after 17 years of interacting with these kids, I've only looked at them on the surface level. Maybe there really is something hidden underneath, some blemish in these children, that they don't deserve the blessing. Or perhaps there's something wrong with Yosef's wife. And then the children would not be good, because I mean in the Gemara Kedushin that, you know, it follows after the mother. Oh, or worse yet, she Yosef, he's going to go into that medrash about who Yosef's wife is in just a minute. Oshi Yosef, Tamei Brisa b'Mitzrayim, or maybe Yosef somehow caused a blemish to his bris, to the covenant in Mitzrayim, v'ava nimshach mi'avos al abanim, and that's a sin which does carry on from fathers to children. K'no de misod ha-pasik, as we know from the famous verse, avoseinu chatum ve'enam, our forefathers, they sinned and now they're gone, and we bear their sins, ki yadua mikavanas ha-shovivim, which is the weeks of shovivim, is an interesting concept, just to quickly fill that in. You were going to...
Yeah, I have one question about Yaakov doesn't see well, or he doesn't have the ability of the... sin. It's maybe also when Yitzhak gave the blessing to Yaakov and Esav, and when he says to Yaakov, Yadayim Yadei Esav, Aval Hakol Kol Yaakov, so maybe he knew that he was giving the blessing to Yaakov, although
right.
He gave us the idea that no, I make a mistake or something, but he saw something deeper.
That's an interesting point, right? If Yaakov had this knowledge where he could figure it out,
yeah,
then certainly you would think that that would be a sort of clue to us,
yeah,
that earlier Yitzchak kind of knew. But
yeah.
I think so. You may be right. And there are other commentaries who use other sources to tell us that Yitzchak kind of knew who it was. And he understood that it's all Hashem's will.
He just maybe didn't want it to give... that Yaakov will feel bad because he's lying to his father, or to respect the will of Rivka.
Right. Maybe. Okay.
Something.
That's good. Ah. Okay. So the pasuk says, Shuvu banim shovavim.
Mm-hmm.
Return, you wayward children. Shovavim is a difficult word, but it means it means wayward, those who have strayed away. That is one of the most important psukim when it comes to doing teshuvah, and that's why a heavenly voice actually rings out every single day and says, Shuvu banim shovavim, my children, my wayward children, come back to me. And those of us who are listening can hear it. But why banim, why children? So we're told that one of the most important sins which are causing the exile to go on are the sins that have to do with the sanctity of the bris, of the holiness of the bris milah, which is a representation of the proper interactions between men and women. Specifically, the intermarriage, which is happening today, which is on some level destroying the Jewish people, that is the blemish of the covenant, which all these, the children that are being born to Jewish people are not Jewish, or they don't know about their Judaism. That is, and it has to do, if according to the holy books, if we would better ourselves and maintain ourselves in a greater state of holiness, we would affect the whole world at large to maintain a greater state of holiness. And because of that, we, to a certain extent, are responsible for all those people who are going off.
I understand what you're saying, what you just said. But there is another possibility. The other possibility is that just as the heat removes the dross from the metal, perhaps those Jews who survive the skolas will represent the Jews who are worthy to sustain Klal Yisrael in the future.
And there is such a suggestion made. But
how do we know which way it goes?
Well, you see, there's a certain amount that we know we're going to lose, and it's that balance of the in-between that we're losing that battle. There is a certain amount that we are losing as a result of that, then there's a certain amount which is just going to go out. And we're saying that that's too much. We're losing too much. Okay. So the holy books, the Kabbalists tell us that there are 6 weeks that are the best time to correct ourselves, to try to maintain in a state of purity. And those are the weeks starting from today, for the next 42 days, starting today, these 6 weeks, Shemos Va'era Bo Bashalach Yisro Mishpatim, which is the story of the Jews coming out of Egypt, which is the time when the Jewish people recollected the holy sparks and made their way out into becoming the Jewish people. This is the time when we're supposed to guard and try to work on protecting those holy sparks. Says the Arizal, that's why these weeks, Shmos Va'era Bo Bashalach Yisro Mishpatim, are the first letters of the word Shovavim. Shuvu banim shovavim, return my children, shovavim, shin vav beis beis yud mem, shmos va'era bo bashalach yisro mishpatim. And it's you don't even have to change it, it's right there in order, because these are the six, and that's why amongst all the communities that have this type of are plugged in into this realm of learning and understanding, they'll usually have during these 6 weeks classes and programs meant to promote greater sanctity and purity. For example, amongst all the Hasidic communities, every year they have a 6-week refresher course on the laws of Nida, which is one example of maintaining this purity, and it's specifically done. They have Shovavim classes, that's what they call it, because this is a time. Anyway, so he says that you see from the process of Shovavim that what we're focused on is the sanctity of the bris, and bringing it back to where he's going, and therefore this is the kind of sin that carries on the exile and creates greater darkness and even carries on to the descendants. So Yaakov felt that if there's something missing from the children of Yosef, it must be that Yosef failed some kind of spiritual test. L'chein Shoal, that's why Yaakov asks, Mi elu, who are these children? She'enem ruin levracha. Why don't they deserve blessing? Mehechan Yatsu, where do they come from? The Heishiv lo Yosef. Yosef says, Banahem, these are my children. Asher nasan li Elokim bazeh. Which God gave me, these are my children, which God gave me, bazeh. What's the zeh? What's this? Vikashu mahu bazeh. You should say, these are the children that God gave me, meaning these are my children and they're from God. And what's the with this? It's just a simple reading of the verse. How do we explain that? So Mavan Mashapirish Rashi Harlosh Dar Ksuba. So Rashi explains that he showed him the Ksuba, meaning that they were legitimately married. Actually, the exact language of Rashi is Harlosh Dar Erisin Ushtar Ksuba. He showed him the contract of the marriage and the contract of the ksuba. Ubikesh Yosef rachmim ala davar v'nachal v'ruch ha-kodesh. And Yosef davened, and Yaakov got back his Holy Spirit. So he says, Od yesh lomar, but I'd like to add another explanation. The Isa b'yalkut, the Medrash tells us, al pasik v'yishmu'u al chamor, that they listened to chamor. This is going back to the story of Shechem and Dina. Shedina nis'abra mishchem. We know that Dina became pregnant from Shechem. V'yalda bas, and she bore a daughter. U'bnei Yaakov ha'yerotzim lahorga, and the Medrash tells us that the sons of Yaakov, and we're assuming that that's the same Shimon and Levi, wanted to kill this child because they felt that this was a child born of wickedness. K'dei shlo yomru ha'olam, the world should not say, she'yesh bazonus b'bnei Yaakov, that there is harlotry in the house of Yaakov. This is exactly what they were thinking. The commentaries discuss how could they kill a child based on this. Anyway, Ma'asa Yaakov. Yaakov clearly disagreed with this. Kasav Shema Kodesh al Tzitz Shalzav. So he wrote a holy name on a plate of gold. Betalu betzavara and hung it around her neck. Vesholcha mibeso and sent her away. So Yaakov made an amulet. Put a holy name on her, which means she would be protected wherever she would go. And he put it around her neck, and she was safe forever, but Yaakov and the sons would never know where she is.
Rabbi, why they say bat zonot in plural instead to say it's because it was Dina, no?
Yeah, but that's the name of it. Bat zonot is the name of the concept. That person is a bat zonot, right? Umiyad ba Michael, came the angel Michael, veviyasal leMitzrayim, and brought her to Egypt, lebeisa shel Potifera, to the house of Potiphar, a place where no one would ever find her. Vishayseru el Yosef, but the whole thing was a setup because she was supposed to marry Yosef. Vihi Asnas, that's Asnas, the wife of Yosef, is actually this young girl. Yosef married his niece, who was sent away with this amulet. V'ishta shal Potiphar, godless like a bas, while she was raised in the house of Potiphar, which explains the Medrash that the wife of Potiphar, she saw in a vision, she had her own crystal balls and necromancy and astrology and all this other stuff, and she saw that greatness would come issue from her through Yosef, and it wasn't through her, it's through her daughter, and that's the dangers of magic and necromancy, is that they give you visions, but they're never clear. And so they always end up being confusing and leading you the wrong way, which is really the story of Macbeth with the double toil and trouble. Where these witches give him all these visions, but they never mean what... Anyway, back to Zeresh Shimshon. So he doesn't fill this in, but we're told by the other Midrashim that what happened was that Yosef was being taken around in the chariot after he was appointed the viceroy, and all the girls were throwing things at him, and this young girl had nothing to throw, so she took off the only thing she owned, which was an amulet, and she threw it at Yosef, and Yosef catches this amulet with God's name on it, or according to another Midrash, it said on it, Bas Yaakov, the daughter of Yaakov, and he said, find that girl, and she became his wife. Anyway, Me'atishaper kamar shanasan li alokim bazeh, God gave me these children with this. Zer Mor Aspa, what was he pointing to? Shehotzilo Osa Hashem, Shayksav Yada Shal Yaakov. He pulled out the amulet. Kedei Laharis Lo. It's interesting because according to this, he had never shown Yaakov this. And it could be, you know, this is based on the commentaries that say that Yosef tried to avoid Yaakov as much as possible. He always kept busy because he didn't want to get into a discussion of, so had he shown him and explained, actually, this is Asnas, and, you know, this is your granddaughter that I'm married to. But Yosef kept it on him. See, Yosef kept this amulet on him. And Yaakov finally calls him at his deathbed and says, no, you need to come. And Yosef had to come because his father was dying. And Yaakov says, so what's the story? What's the story with your children? And Yosef pulls out the amulet and says, this is your handwriting. This is the amulet that you made. This is the wife that I married. This is his wife. So his children are in a state of holiness. That's just the... I'm just going to say that. And then the end of the paragraph, the next one, which is...
From all these grandchildren, only Ephraim Menashe could bless
him.
So I explained on Wednesday because he was giving Yosef the firstborn right. So he was dividing, he was cutting them in half. He was giving Menashe one shevet and Ephraim a separate shevet, and that was a separate process, separate from the rest of the children. So we're assuming he gave all his grandchildren blessings, but before he called everyone else in, he called Yosef, Ephraim, and Menashe and said, I'm giving you this extra portion, I'm dividing Yosef in half, Ephraim, and Menashe, you are now Keruvim v'Kishimon, you are like tribes on your own. And then he called everyone else in, but this was a special thing. So he goes on and he says that, and then Yaakov looked closer at Yosef and he studied his face and he saw this kedusha in Yosef through the wisdom of the partsuf, chachmas partsuf, and that's why he said, that's why Yaakov says, now I can't believe this. I thought I'd never see your face. Now I see your face that you are in holiness. But not only are you in holiness and you survived all these tests that you faced, but even your children. Hashem arranges that same child born to Dina, who I sent away and disappears, becomes the wife of Yosef in order to make Menashe and Ephraim children born of great holiness. And therefore, Yaakov blesses Ephraim and Menashe. And we should also merit that we should have these visions that allow us to see the truth. And we should also be able to maintain our sanctity, especially during these times.